Yeah, we should think about the question whether the Schrödinger representation is actually irreducible. Of course it is, but maybe we really should see or think about the argument. So let me write this down precisely. So the Schrödinger representation of the Weyl relations which we can write down very explicitly. So the Schrödinger representation of the Weyl relations. So this, of course, is given on the Hilbert space, which is the L2 of R with respect to Lebesgue measure. And our unitary groups are given as follows. The one corresponding to the operator P. This is given by shifting our functions by t, and the v's, which correspond to the operator q, they just multiply with a complex phase. So they multiply with e to the I tx times f of x. Yeah, and now we are claiming that this is irreducible. So this is irreducible representation. Okay, so this means by definition that we should not be able to find an invariant subspace or a non-trivial subspace which is invariant under both actions of u and of t. So let us assume we have such an invariant subspace, and then we should see that this leads to a contradiction. Yeah, so we assume we have an invariant subspace, which is non-trivial. So assume there is a non-trivial invariant subspace. Let's say non-trivial subspace K in my Hilbert space, which is invariant under U and under V. So which means UT maps K into itself, and VS maps K into itself, and this is true for all T and S. Yeah, okay, and this means, what does it mean that K is non-trivial? So K is non-trivial means it's not just consisting of zero, so it contains at least a function which is non-zero. And non-trivial also means it's not the biggest possible sub-Hilbert space, which means it cannot be everything, which means if I'm taking the orthogonal complement of it, this can also not be empty. So I must also find something in the orthogonal complement of this Hilbert space, of this K. So this means I have non-trivial, non-zero functions both in K and the orthogonal complement of K. And this, we will see, cannot be. Then we have, so first of all, we have something in K which is non-zero because we assume K is not trivial, so it does not only consist of the zero, so there must be an F which is not a zero function. And then we also have a G in the orthogonal complement. This is also not zero because we assume K is not everything. So there must also be something non-trivial in the orthogonal complement, and let us call this G. Yeah, and then I can look on inner products, of course, between G and F. This is zero because G is in the orthogonal complement to the space where F is. But the point is that if I'm applying my V and also the U's, I still keep these orthogonality relations. So namely, yeah, maybe let me write this here. So from this we get that if I'm looking on the inner product between G and now, of course I could take F, but I apply the U's and the V's to this F. So I can also take a VT for any T and a US for any S, apply this to F, and then because K is invariant under the action of both of them, so this here is in K, US maps this into K, and then the VT maps this again into something in K. So what I get here is still in K, and G is an orthogonal complement of K, which means that the inner product between this is zero. And this is true for all S and T. And this gives now very strong conditions on G and F. I mean, we want to see, it cannot be that we have such G and F. So, and what we are saying here is that I have G, and for F, I'm applying all those operations here, and I still can keep this F orthogonal to G. And here I'm doing too many operations, and we have to see that this cannot be the case. So maybe let me write down what I really have here. So namely, this inner product, what is this? So this is the inner product of the function g, okay, g bar. And then I have to take the function which is given by vt us applied to f, and we know what this is. So namely, the effect of the v is to multiply with this exponential factor, and u makes a translation. So this is e to the I tx times f of x plus s. The US makes a translation by s, and the vt multiplies with this factor here, and we take the L2 inner product between this, and we know that this is equal to zero for all s and t. Now you see that this here are very strong conditions. We have two functions, and so the inner product between them is zero, but it is still zero if I'm shifting my f by all possibilities, and I'm multiplying it also by all possible complex unitary factors. And the point is, I just have to see that such functions cannot exist. I mean, at least one of them must be equal to zero. This would be the contradiction. And this is indeed the case, and it's just coming down to finding arguments why this is not possible. And in principle, one argument, for example, is to see what I have here. You see, I have here this e factor, which means I'm taking the Fourier transform of the rest. So maybe one way of seeing this integral here, I can read this as the Fourier transform. So the Fourier transform in the variable t, I'm integrating over x, so I'm taking the Fourier transform in the variable t of this function here as a function of x. So this is the Fourier transform, let's say, of a function which depends on s. S is just an argument here, so it's true for any s. So it's a function at the argument t, but it's a Fourier transform of a function, of which function? Of the function hs of x, which is just everything what I have here as a function of x. Hs of x is g bar of x multiplied with f x plus s. So this, if I'm fixing s, then I can consider this as a function in t. This tells me that this as a function in t is equal to zero, but this as a function in t is actually the Fourier transform of this function here. So this tells me the Fourier transform of this function is equal to zero, which means the the function itself must be equal to zero. So what I have here above says that the Fourier transform is equal to zero. And this is for all s. S is fixed for this argument. But the Fourier transform being equal to zero means that hs is equal to zero. And we have this argument now for all s. So what we get from this is actually that this here, this function, is equal to zero as a function in x, but this is true for all s. And now you see, this can also, so here you have this function, you multiply pointwise those two functions, but you're shifting this here by any amount, and you say this is pointwise equal to zero, and this can only be if one of those two functions is equal to zero. So this gives here that either g is equal to zero or f is equal to zero, and this is of course a contradiction to my assumption, which I got from the existence of a non-trivial invariant subspace, that I find both f and g, both are different from zero, which have this property here. So this is a contradiction. And so this shows that my assumption was not correct, and this means that my representation is irreducible. Okay, good. So this shows the Schrödinger representation is irreducible, and now we really can address the big question whether any irreducible representation of the Weyl relations is unitarily equivalent to the Schrödinger equation. And this will be the content of the next chapter.